All right, welcome everyone. This is my second week demo and some learnings. So I had some original goals for this week, which I ended up not pursuing because I wanted to instead learn more Rust. And so I decided to rewrite what I did last week in Rust. And I also looked a little bit into GUI libraries, and I looked a little bit at different languages, but not too much there. So I mostly focused on this. So that ended up working pretty well. I made this application. It's pretty much exactly the same as you saw in the previous videos. The main difference here is that the slider here is an actual DOM element. It's just a regular HTML input. Because I did want to try how to interface with the DOM just to see how that works. But yeah, I didn't have too much trouble moving this over. I learned a bunch of Rust and a bunch about WebAssembly, so that's what I'll be talking about for most of this video. Also, this week I talked with the Makepad people, so I mentioned them in the first video. They are implementing they're implementing a whole editing application completely in Rust, and it compiles to WebAssembly but also to various other platforms. I don't know if there are any other projects that are pursuing something quite like this, where they're basically re-implementing everything from scratch. But I ended up talking to them a little bit, and it was quite interesting. They are huge fans of Rust. One of the founders worked at Mozilla for a while, and so I think used Rust a bit there. And yeah, like I said, they are really implementing everything from scratch, from rendering, layout, animation. They bind with various rendering systems, very low-level systems. They're abstracting over the different shader languages. They even implemented a whole hot reloading system for Rust. It's pretty nuts. It's very impressive. And they really encouraged me to go deeper on Rust and use it as the language to build applications in. Now, I don't know, like they've been working on this for quite a while, and it seems that they're working towards bringing something to production for people to actually use, but it's not quite there yet, so I'm not quite sure what I should be doing with like they have a lot of code that is MIT licensed, but it's not it's deliberately not packaged in a way that you can start using right now. So it's a little bit modular, but it's lacking a lot of documentation, and they're changing stuff all the time. But it is very interesting to see that they are working on this. And I talked to them, and they didn't seem to know really about any other project that is trying to re-implement basically everything that you get from HTML and CSS in their own system. But I don't know, maybe there are other people out there, but I would love to learn about that. So let's talk about my impressions of Rust so far. I found it has a somewhat steep learning curve, and it's a very complex language, but it seems very solid at this point, pretty stable. It seems to meet my expectations for a C++ done right type of language. And also what the folks from Makepad were saying was that what they really liked about it is you do have to invest a bit more time up front to make everything work with the borrow checker and stuff like that. But then when you run your program, it usually just works without too many bugs, certainly without any bugs related to memory and stuff like that. So that's that seems like a great fit for what it was originally designed for, which is applications like Firefox, I think are now in part written in Rust. I'm not super sure what exactly, but like large complex applications that really require strong performance seem to be great to write in Rust. Doesn't seem great for scripting. I wrote a little toy, like small program, and even in that small program, that was really kind of like a scripting type program, I still had to use like borrows and moves and unwraps and sort of all the things that you don't normally want to think about when you're scripting. There is a book though, Data Analysis with Rust Notebooks. So I don't know, maybe people are interested in this sort of thing. And this actually belonged to the Makepad. I talked about that already. Yeah. So then I really tried to target WebAssembly here. I didn't attempt to also make a version that just renders to OpenGL. Because I wanted to try to see how it works to work with the DOM. The DOM code to bind with Rust, the code in Rust to do DOM stuff is not so great. It feels very not rusty, I guess. You have to do a lot of things because JavaScript works a lot with closures and promises and those sorts of things, and you have to fit your Rust code to work with that, and that is just not the best fit. I looked at what Makepad does and talked to them about this, and they just do a lot of this stuff manually, where they have a little bit of JavaScript glue that they wrote themselves, and they're not really using any of the built-in libraries that do this binding for you. And that seems like maybe that's the way to go. I'm not quite sure yet. I haven't done enough of this yet. And then as I was trying to learn more about how Rust operates with WebAssembly, I learned a lot about the limitations of WebAssembly. So these are pretty big limitations if you're making a large application, but they do seem like they're all actively being worked on. So we can expect that if you were to write a big application in WebAssembly now, then hopefully over time these concerns would be addressed. So one of them is just 32-bit memory. So actually my friend Wouter, who I mentioned in an earlier video about Lobster, he's working, like for his day job, he's working on implementing 64-bit memory for WebAssembly. So that's coming down the pipe. Threading really doesn't seem really nice right now. The standard library thread implementation of Rust doesn't work out of the box with WebAssembly. There are some other libraries that try to fill this gap. There are also just some inherent issues with WebAssembly. So for example, you can't actually, when you run your WebAssembly in the main thread, you can't do any blocking because it would block the rendering of the web page. So if you want to do things sort of the standard Rust way where it's okay to block on IO, for example, you have to do that in a web worker, but then you kind of lose the bindings that you had with the DOM. So you have to somehow manage this. And if we're going to do our own bindings anyway, then maybe that is not such a big issue, but this definitely doesn't seem to be easily solved out of the box. And then there's a lot of stuff I don't quite understand how it works yet. Supposedly we should have some sort of shared memory now. So if you have multiple threads, they should be able to use the same memory and use like a different mechanisms to make sure that you're not accessing the same memory at the same time and so on. But it's not entirely clear to me how that works. Like, how does allocation work, for example? What happens if the WebAssembly heap has to grow? I don't know how that is currently coordinated between the different threads by the different libraries. but I'm quite interested in learning a bit more about that, because this is definitely, you know, threads are very important if you want to make performant applications. And then on the point of memory, there seems to be quite a few issues. Like WebAssembly currently has this model, which is just one allocation of linear memory. And you can grow it, you can't shrink it. There's no notion of virtual memory or having sort of like multiple memory allocations. So it feels very similar to sort of the old style system calls, which are like, I think, BRK and like, yeah, break, I think is, I don't know exactly what this stands for, but this is a very similar sort of old API from, you know, decades ago, that works in a similar way, but that has now, in most computers, right, and most operating systems, been replaced by mmap, which will allow you to use virtual memory, so you can allocate new regions of memory, but they look like they're sort of in the same memory space as what you already had. So it looks like some stuff is in the works to support something that looks a little bit like this. There's also some other issues like JavaScript pointers, which are really typed arrays, are lost on when the heap grows, and that can happen from Rust, so it can really happen at any time. So you can't really keep pointing from JavaScript into Rust structures, like into WebAssembly memory. You have to point into it and then immediately use it, because it might invalidate like on the next stick or something, or even during execution. So that's not so great. And then, yeah, this has the issue that you get memory fragmentation. You don't have that so much with virtual memory through mmap. And there are apparently some issues with mobile. Like there were some issues on GitHub about that. And like I said, you can't shrink it. I think that's also an issue with mobile. Like if you don't want to use too much memory, we don't care too much about these. Like I'm not too interested in building mobile applications at this point, but it's still something important to keep in mind. So anyway, there's a bunch of limitations, but that are all pretty fundamental and low level, but they do seem to be all being worked on. There's different proposals for different of these things, and you know, like the platform is definitely maturing actively. And my sense is that it might be best to write applications sort of WASM first, because you just have all these limitations that you don't have when you build a native application. And so it's probably, you know, if you have to pick some platform to optimize for first, it's probably WASM, and then you can port to native later, as long as you don't use the DOM and that sort of stuff too much, right? Like browser features. So there's some implications for my projects, right? Like, so my first idea was sort of an application framework for WASM, which I would want just for building applications which I've been doing for many years. Like if I were to build a V2 of WebVis, right, like which this is kind of inspired on, then I would want to do that somehow in Rust and WASM, probably. So I think, you know, Rust is pretty good, WASM is probably good enough, as long as you can work around these limitations for now. I think if you're going to build an application like this, you probably want to keep everything in Rust and don't use the DOM. So you could still use it for a native application as well, which should still be faster in many cases. This is what the Makepad people are doing too. But all the existing GUI libraries, I looked at it a little bit, they just don't really seem to give you the same stuff that CSS and the DOM gives you. Most I couldn't find anything that even comes close. There's one project that is that you can't use directly from Rust or C++ for that matter, which is Flutter. So this is a project by Google, and it was originally designed for building applications that target Android and iOS, but they've very recently, like a week ago or so, just expanded this to also be useful for building native applications, and they added WebAssembly with WebGL as a render target. And like their system is implemented in Dart, which is not a language that is used very much outside of Google projects. And I have, you know, some concerns around that. But at least at first glance, Flutter seems to be pretty well done. Otherwise, it's just it looks really good. It has like it's very full featured with all sorts of different input types and UI elements and animations and those sorts of things. So I think it would be interesting to you know, if I at some point have to do some GUI stuff, I could maybe take some inspiration from what they are doing and seeing if we can maybe port some of that stuff over to Rust. That'd be a very significant project, but that's one of the avenues, one of the options I'm thinking about. And of course, the Makepad people are doing this, right? Like they are implementing everything from scratch. So it's, but they have been working on that for a long time already too. So it's definitely a serious commitment to build a GUI library. But what I like about this approach is I wouldn't have to really reinvent everything again. I can take an existing project that a bunch of very smart people have developed good APIs for. And I can kind of use that as a starting point, so I don't have to come up with my own APIs, because, you know, there's way too many. Like, looking around at GUI libraries, there's way too many out there made by people who saw a problem like this and then decided to start making something, but then abandoned it halfway through. Or yeah, I don't want to get into a situation like that. Like, if I'm going to do something like that, then it should really just be explicitly just a learning project or something. But I would want something like this for actual, you know, real life use. So not. I don't think I'm going to start on a big project like that. But it's certainly an interesting idea. And then for the notebook application, Rust is probably fine to build the application itself, right? But using Rust as a scripting language, maybe not so great. Like, I don't think it's terrible, right? Like, there's the book about data analysis with Rust notebooks, and you can kind of make it work. But it's not ideal. But I also don't think that there's a great alternative out there right now, right? Like, then we're getting back into the very experimental languages. And at this point, I think I've kind of decided that that's probably not a great idea, but I don't know. I'm still keeping the door open there. Like, if there's like a huge value add from taking an existing more experimental language and using that in a notebook or something, then I'm definitely still open to it. But my current thinking is that, you know, maybe it's not ideal to use Rust for scripting, but maybe it's fine as a starting point. And then maybe I can see if I want to integrate a more experimental language later. But yeah, that's my thinking there. And then another possibility is to say, okay, well, let's really just target the web. Because then you can keep the DOM and JavaScript, and you can kind of, like, that was my fourth idea, right? For my original list, which is better interoperability between different languages. And so maybe it's okay to have some JavaScript and have some Rust and use a notebook application as a way to stitch them together. I'm not quite sure what that would look like in practice, but I think that it's an interesting idea. But I've also been looking already at some libraries for drawing charts and so on in Rust, and there are a few out there that seem pretty good. So maybe it's not that necessary to keep the DOM or keep JavaScript, but it might be useful to make it more accessible. I don't know. And you have the downside when you do this that you are now stuck with the browser, right? You can't target a native application anymore. And it's interesting, right? Like if we do this, then at some point you still want some GUI library, right? Like if you want a button or a slider or anything like that to make your application interactive, we would still need some of this stuff, but we could go about it in very piecemeal, right? Like if we do it in the context of a notebook, the requirements for the kind of things that you want to draw on the screen are just like a lot. There's just typically a lot less of it, at least in the beginning. And so that might also be a benefit of starting with something like a notebook application and then slowly figuring out a GUI library as the need arises. So that's kind of where I'm at. That's what I learned. I have some potential goals for next week. So like I mentioned, I could either really focus on the application framework, learn more about Flutter's rendering, maybe start building a Flutter clone in pure Rust. I think it makes sense as a long-term direction, right? But it would just be a ton of work. And then I could also focus more on the notebook side of things. And my main idea there would be to have like a Rust plus JS notebook, or maybe just a Rust notebook, Rust+wasm notebook. Maybe we don't have to start with JavaScript for now. So this would be basically, you know, you write a couple of lines of Rust and it executes, but like all the execution happens in the browser, right? Because there is a Jupyter notebook implementation for Rust out there, but it runs all in the backend, like you normally have with a Jupyter notebook. But I could take basically that concept and just have all the execution happen in the browser, so you can actually build something simple like this, right? Like this would be actually, again, an interesting example to build in a notebook like that, where you write a couple of lines of code that says, okay, you know, we want to open a file and we want to render one of these sliders, and then we want to hook it up to a 3D rendering, and all of that should be possible in our notebook. We could still use the DOM for some UI in the beginning if we want to, especially if we want to keep it sort of a Rust plus JS notebook, but we can also say it will be pure Rust and we're just going to implement like a little slider as our first GUI component or something, and then slowly build out the types of UI components that you can use. We have a lot of options in how to deal with that. And then for the compilation, it would be pretty hard, I think, right now to embed the entire Rust compiler in WebAssembly. I haven't looked too much at it, but I haven't seen anyone else do that yet. So it might not be easy, or it might be. I don't know. Just it's a complex piece of software, and especially once you start dealing with package management and stuff like that. So for starters, we could just keep the compilation on the backend, but then ship the WebAssembly executable back to the front end. So I'm leaning towards doing this because I could get something to work quickly. Like I said, there are some downsides, some trade-offs, but at least we would have something to start working with, and then we could incrementally improve on that. So this is at the moment pretty appealing. Also another benefit is that there is an existing project, like I said, that integrates Rust with Jupyter. And so they've already done some work to make it so that, you know, you can have different blocks of code, but you can refer to variables from earlier blocks and so on. Like it figures out what the variables are and preserves them across execution. So that is quite cool. We can we can probably use at least some of that code, if not all of it. So that's what I'm leaning towards. I guess you will find out what I ended up doing next week. Thanks a lot.